Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you know, he said, "Ama inni a'lamukum billah wa akhshakum lillah." From amongst all of you, I am the one that knows about Allah the most. And because of that knowledge that he has about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's the one that fears him the most. The more knowledge a person has, the closer they are to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The kids that finished the Qur'an, where are they today? This is really the biggest issue that we're seeing. Their belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and their understanding of Islam. All of our parents have come to this realization that back home might have been better, you know, than to come here. But again, you know, hindsight's 2020.
Assalamu alaikum. You guys are tuning in to an episode of Talk Ya Haqq, the podcast where we reflect upon our struggles, our stories, and our experiences, inshallah, deriving lessons and wisdom in these confusing times, inshallah. My name is Idris. I'm your host, and I have across from here today, Sheikh Fuad.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you?
Alhamdulillah.
How are mashallah. You mashallah, I'm doing good. You know, I told you this earlier in the beginning, like, you were in my mind immediately when I started this podcast. You know, the wisdoms I've derived from you, so, and the beneficial knowledge. But starting off, how are you? How are you, Sheikh?
Alhamdulillah. We're living some, you know, tough times, wow, and trying to take advantage as best as we can.
Mashallah. Alhamdulillah. So, mashallah, with you being an imam, being a person of knowledge, alhamdulillah, I kind of wanted to ask you, like, your journey. With that, I think that is a point of subhanAllah, a lot of people, because you're kind of from here.
Yeah.
You know, growing up here, what pushed you towards that route, that avenue, being a person of knowledge?
You know, it started when I was young. Before we even moved to America, I used to go to madrasa in Nairobi. And I remember when I was, I think, six, there was, I used to go to a madrasa. The name of it was Baytul Mal on 2nd Street. It was a Pakistan, our teacher was Pakistani, and we also had a Somali Quran teacher. And one day in the month of Ramadan, I remember I was in the 5th juz. So this is, you know, at six.
6 years old?
6 years old, you know.
Mashallah.
So I'm at the 5th juz. And then we're praying Taraweeh. So it was a boarding school. But for those that, you know, couldn't afford to be fully there, you could go there halftime, you know, from morning to night, and then go home to sleep. And you'd have to have, you know, your food brought and so on. So we used to be those that were unfortunate, you know, not to sleep over and spend time there. So one Ramadan, we go to the masjid, and there was a young kid, I would say maybe he was 8. He got to lead Taraweeh. And this was, you know, in the beginning nights. And that day I told myself, why is this kid that is the same age as me leading and I'm standing over here? You know, so that time I was like, one day I'm going to be standing where that child is standing. So that, you know, that's the earliest time I can remember wanting to be an imam. Wanting to be, you know, a person that's, you know, seeking knowledge. So alhamdulillah, I was able to, you know, continue doing Quran there. And then eventually we moved to the States. We moved to the States, I think I was seven or eight. We moved to the States, and, you know, coming to a new country, all of these thoughts that you had are gone. So we lived in Florida for 9 months. While we were there, we went to a madrasa that was an American madrasa, only 2 days a week. So this was different than, you know, the 5 days that, or the 6 days that we used to go to. And now 2 days, and then I was like, you know, this is not really how I want to learn the Quran. So I once we moved to Seattle after that, we, you know, just lived the American life. Live that, go to school, play basketball after school. So this became my life.
And how old were you at this time in your life?
This time, I would say I was maybe 9, 10, around there. So I was, you know, living just the typical American life. And then, you know, what really changed the life or the path that I was going on was that in 2006, my younger brother was born. His name is Umar. At that time, he was the youngest. Right now, there's another one that's younger than him. So when he was born with, you know, a lot of issues. You know, he was born with cerebral palsy and some other developmental delays. So he was Alhamdulillah, he was a healthy kid, but he wasn't a normal child. So we would have to really take care of him. And the first few years, my mom was a stay-at-home mom. So she was, at that time he was small. So there wasn't really a lot of things to do. Then when I went to high school, this is when he started getting heavier. He was growing, but he couldn't walk. He couldn't talk. So he needed a lot of attention. So my life basically became, being the eldest, that I would go to school. Coming home from school would be dedicated to this kid. At a young age. So my mom, she would want to do things around the house, but she wouldn't be able to do it. So we would have to do it. Someone would always, have to help. And my father would always be working. So I would spend time just, raising this kid. So I didn't have a lot of time to, do other things. It was go from school, go to home and, take care of this kid to the best way that I could. I would complain. I would, say, why don't I get to do all of these other things? And then slowly my younger siblings got, older and they were able to start helping. But by that time, I remember I was 16, right? When my the brother that's right after me was able to take up responsibilities. Gotcha. But then, he ended up doing a lot of other activities, right? With school and all of these things. So still I had to, really take care of, be home after school, whenever my mom needed me. Then when I was 16, I was like, okay, I can't just spend my time here, just raising this child and not having, things to do. I received a call from my grandfather, and he used to call us, here and there. He was someone that, studied for over 40 years. He had two doctorate degrees from Azhar. So whenever he would talk, he would always talk about, us seeking knowledge and, not forgetting the path that we're on. I think up until I got married, I used to use the same Quran that he gave me while we were in Nairobi. Right. So if you go to the back of it, the name is still on there. He gave one to me, to my brother, to my dad, and he left other books for us, So he would always call and he would say, this is what you guys have to do. Remind us, this is the life that, you have to embark on. So I was like, okay, let's see what, how I can do this thing. And then Alhamdulillah, he knew the imams of the Oromo Masjid here. So he was like, these people are here, go to them, learn from them. So I said, okay, let's go. And I remember I was 17, started going to the classes that they had there. And we started going over, the way they teach knowledge is different than, the typical way of learning. So the way they do it is they just focus on the Quran and the Hadith. Right? So the Hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And I remember when I went, they were doing Riyadu Salihin. So they went through the whole Riyadu Salihin. It took about a year to finish. We went from there, we went to Bulughul Maram. This is another hadith book. I did that with them, alhamdulillah. After that, we moved on to do Tajreed, which is a combination of Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. And it was, put together. So we went over these books. Then, alhamdulillah, I graduated high school. And then I wanted to expand on this knowledge. So then I decided, I have to go and study abroad. At that time, my grandfather, may Allah have mercy on him, he passed away in 2017. At that time, I would call him and tell him, where should I go? What should I do? He was like, oh, I know these people from the time that I used to teach in Azhar. Go to this place. And these people would take care of you. And alhamdulillah, I was able to go there and meet some people that were able to help me. Spent some time there. Benefited as much as I could. And then came back to the United States. When I came back to the United States, it took, maybe a couple months, maybe 6-7 months. And then I became an imam at a masjid in West Seattle, Masjid Tawheed. And that, thinking back now, I wish that I hadn't taken the job.
Really?
Yeah, subhanAllah. I've always wanted, going back to the first time I wanted, my whole thing was, I want to lead Taraweeh. Right. So it was like, I want to lead Taraweeh because I saw that, someone that was a little bit older than me leading while I'm just sitting here. Then it went, when I was 17, that was the first time I led Taraweeh. Right. So I was like, okay, this part of it is done. What I wanted to accomplish was done. What else is there to do? Right. Then when I started studying, now it became more like, I really want to do this for myself. You know, and then I feel like, you know, coming back to the States and taking an imam role, it I had to grow up again fast. You know, I didn't have that time to just be, at that time I was 20.
Right? Wow. 20 years old.
Yeah. So I'm like, you know, what's going on? You know, it's moving too fast. I want to, you know, yeah. I want to be a normal 20-year-old. But alhamdulillah, you know, Allah has his plans. Then, you know, we went from there, then moved to the masjid that I'm at right now.
How long were you at that previous masjid?
I think 2 years. Yeah, I think 2 years I was there, two Ramadans. And then alhamdulillah, it was, you know, moved to a different masjid. And that's where I'm at now.
MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. Wow, you were an imam at a young age. 20 years old. That's how old I am now.
I was. And, if I went back, uh-huh. you know, knowing what I know now, I would not become an imam.
What would you have done?
I would have continued studying, mm-hmm. right? So this is, I feel like knowledge, the people that you're surrounded by, it, you know, it has an impact on what you want to learn. Mm-hmm. If I go back now, I would never come back to the States, right? I want to study to the point where I feel secure in the knowledge that I have. Mm-hmm. And I feel secure in, you know, being able to really help people, right? Because now coming back because of, you know, how limited knowledge is here, anybody can go and, you know, it's very different. Right. So I wish I waited until I was a little bit older, more mature, you know, and alhamdulillah, you know, one of the things that I don't regret as much that, you know, I see people that, you know, do become imam at a young age is that there would be statements and things like that that would they would later regret in life. Mm. Alhamdulillah, I have those things, but they're not on social media. They're not, you know, recorded. They're not things that are out there. So they're things that I regret, but not a lot of people know about it.
Gotcha.
You know? And so if I was, you know, went back, I would continue studying, mm. you know, alhamdulillah now, like I've gone back into studying and it's, I want to do more, you know,
yeah,
without the responsibility of being an imam of a masjid.
SubhanAllah. Yeah. So mashallah, tabarakAllah, like I want to start off with the fact that you were kind of in your household and you were immersed with your family and yeah. you didn't really have much external influences. Yeah. I had an episode with my cousin, Liban Idris, mm-hmm. and one of the things we talked about was growing up in a Muslim household, but also having a non-Muslim external environment mm-hmm. and how that kind of that tug of war, right, kind of pulled one yeah. one way or another. And I want to ask you, do you feel like it was kind of like of a blessing or what was your take on the fact that you had one environment, but beyond school, you come home? What do you think, had that not been the case? What do you think?
Oh, SubhanAllah. Like? If that was not the case, I wouldn't be here, right? I would be just like everybody else, mm. you know, just a, what happens to all of our, you know, people that live that life mm. of where at home they have that Islamic background. And then outside they, you know, they're surrounded with the, you know, non-Islamic background. Mm. And of course you spend more time outside.
Exactly.
Because when we, if you really look at it, the Islamic background or the Islamic house is you're looking at the father and the mother. And for us, majority of our parents, they're not home.
That's true.
You know, so even when we're home, we're most likely going to be, you know, in front of the TV. So it doesn't...
On our phones.
On our phones. So especially now. Back in the day, like when I was going to high school, social media was not this crazy. You know, I remember we had MySpace. Facebook was just starting out and it was not this crazy, mm. you know. But now it's like even crazier. You would have, you know, parents that are Muslims practicing. They go to the masjid. The child is, you know, spending majority of the time on social media. All these doubts are creeping into him. You see him as someone that's inside of the house, mm. but his reality is not inside of the house, you know. So for me, it really played a big part, you know, being, and then on top of that, I feel like, you know, going to madrasa at a young age, growing up in an Islamic country, when I came here, I wasn't too young to forget what I had learned. Mm. Right? So I still knew the importance of, you know, praying and doing these type of things. But of course, there were times when, you know, you're a young child and you struggle with these things. Alhamdulillah, you know, my father, you know, may Allah reward him. He spent a lot of time making sure that wherever we were going to madrasa. We were learning Quran. We knew who we were as Muslims. And then just, you know, making sure that we knew who we were. And my parents, you know, they, to this day, they when they pray, they're not like, you know, us. We pray our fard prayer, then khalas, that's it. They pray every sunnah prayer. they fast as much as they can. So even now, when I go to my parents' house, I would pray, like I would go and I would lead them in salah. After I'm done leading them in salah, I would see my mother or my father, they would get up and they would pray sunnah. But for me, like, you know, sometimes when I'm there, it doesn't come as natural to, you know, for, like for them, it seems like this is a routine. Mm-hmm. We get up, we're going to pray sunnah, whatever salah it is, right? So like, that's the type of house I grew up in, alhamdulillah, you know. And after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's seeing, you know, my father read Quran a lot, seeing, you know, my mother always listening to lectures, making sure that, like, I don't think they did anything that was ever made me doubt, like, why are they telling me something is haram and they're doing this thing? Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of times what we have in households is you have parents that they want khair for their kids. They want good for their children, but they do some things that is opposite to what they're telling them. Mm-hmm. And then this, you know, a lot revolves around, you know, music.
Exactly. So
you'd have them listening to their cultural music. And then when the kid listens to his culture's music, they tell him that's haram. And the kid is—he's confused. He's like, you know, why are you listening to music? They say, no, this is you know, Somali music, this is Oromo music, this is whatever it is. And the kid, in reality, he's going to be confused, and he's going to say, that's their culture, this is my culture, so I can listen to this. For me, like, I never had those type of debates or those type of conversations, because I never heard, like, my parents never played music in the house, right? So, and all of the things they told us to do, there were things I seen them do. When they tell us to pray, I would see them praying. When my dad would tell us to read Quran, I would see him read Quran, right? So it was always like, this is how we have to be. So alhamdulillah, you know, I'm very happy that, you know, this is what Allah blessed me with.
Alhamdulillah, like they led by example.
Yeah.
And that's another thing that we touched on, leading by example, because the external environment is already trying to grab you.
Yeah, that's it. You know, that's what it's trying to, like, this country, you know, we have to be honest with ourselves. We think that this country is only against Muslims. When in reality, this country is against all religion. If we look at those that have been here longer, you know, than us, the Christians, today their churches are being turned into mosques because they cannot have, you know, they don't have people to go there. You have, I was just, you know, reading an article recently where 40 or 70% of kids between the ages of 14 and 20, they're less religious than they were in the 80s and in the 90s, right? So what's happened, and these are, you know, Christians, this is not, you know, looking at Muslims, the amount of the churchgoers are the parents and not the children, right? So even them, they couldn't hold on to their beliefs. And again, this is a country that was built on, you know, Christian beliefs.
Yeah.
And now they cannot hold on to those beliefs, right? So if they couldn't do it, what makes us think that, you know, we are going to be able to have a fight with this country, right? So it comes to these, it's really powerful. They want you to leave, you know, all of your beliefs, all of your tradition, all of your culture, for you to be just like everybody else, right?
Follow your desire.
That's it. That's it. This is what America is, right? What was the reason that we left our countries for? Alhamdulillah, now, you know, there are some people that left for, they had valid reasons to leave their countries to come here. But if you ask those people now, just like, you know, sometimes I ask my parents how they feel about coming to America, they tell you the different struggles that they had, and they wish they had stayed there. Over there, they feared, you know, the biggest fear they had was there was no food, right? What am I going to feed my kids? What are my kids going to wear? How am I gonna, you know, basically survive as a human being, right? But you come here, you don't worry about your food, you don't worry about your clothes, but what you worry about is my kids are losing their akhirah. So is this an exchange that, you know, I was struggling with my clothes back home, I was struggling with their food back home? Now that I've come here, we're struggling with, they have all of the things they need for the dunya.
And more.
But the akhirah is going. Right. So I feel like all of our parents have come to this realization that back home might have been better, you know, than to come here. But again, you know, hindsight's 2020. So
alhamdulillah. I feel like that's very powerful. I think one thing that you touched on about like going to a madrasa. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned in Nairobi, it was like this full time type of thing.
Yeah.
But here, unfortunately, it's like 2 days out the week type of thing. Right. So it's not as much to sustain, you know, the values and customs. So I want to ask you, as a person who ran like a duksia or madrasa, am I right in saying
that?
I remember one day at work, there was a coworker that came up to me and mashallah, she had two children and she mentioned that her children attended one of your duksis. And she talked about how that, I think that program ended in that part of town. And then she told me, she's like, Idris, for the first time ever, my kids loved going to duksi. You know, they enjoyed, they'd be like, I can't wait to go to duksi. I can't wait. So I want to ask you, like, why do you think that's the case? Why do you think that's the case that the kids feel like they could connect with a public school and their school with their friends, like the secular studies, but they can't connect in the majority from what I see, right? Being brought up here, they can't connect with the schools that teach deen and Islam. What did you do differently?
So, you know, one of the things that we have to realize is that schools here, our children spend majority of the time there. Whether they don't like it in the beginning, if you spend that much time at any place, eventually you're going to grow to love it, right? So, and it's easier to connect with, you know, teachers and the people that are at school because they want to do the same thing that you want to do, right? They want you to be, again, just whatever you want, we'll get it for you, right? Follow that desire of yours. When we started the madrasa, and I believe it was in Kent, one of the things that we wanted to do was we're only here for 2 days, right? We're here 2 days. We have to really look at what are these kids able to do in these 2 days? And we realized that, you know, most parents, they want their kids to go and memorize the Quran in 2 days. And they think that, you know, they think back to their days. We used to go to madrasa and we memorized the Quran. Why are these kids going to madrasa and not memorizing? But they forget that, you know, they lived in an Islamic country, Islamic background. Dhuhr time, you hear the adhan, you go and you pray. You go to madrasa, not 2 days out of the week, but you go 5-6 days out of the week. So you're always there. And then they think that you can get the same result, you know, here. So we every parent that came, we told them, this is not a place that your child is going to memorize the Quran. But what we are going to do is we are going to make sure that they know enough about Islam that if they decided to want to memorize the Quran, they would know how to go about it, right? So we made it a place where it wasn't so heavily focused on, you know, just memorizing the Quran, but rather a place where, you know, a child is learning about their religion. And this is a big part of their lives, right? So we would, majority of the time, it would be spent on, you know, understanding the things that they're doing. Why are their parents sending them to Quran class? Why do they get yelled at when they don't pass Quran? Why are their parents always, you know, yelling at them to pray? Why are they doing all of these things? So let's teach them these things so they know themselves that, you know, I don't need my parents to tell me I need to memorize the Quran. If I know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, and this is the reason I'm doing it for, why do I have to, you know, why do my parents have to tell me to pray? If it's not going to benefit them, but it's going to benefit me. So I'm going to, you know, want to pray on my own. So that's how we, you know, designed the madrasa to where this is how we wanted to do. And then on top of all of this, it was, we knew all of the students, right? We knew their names. We knew what they liked to do. We knew the things that they didn't like. So we made it, you know, feel like this, they're here. This is a place that we do care about you. You know, you are yourself. You're not just, you know, a child that, you know, the parents came and dropped off, but you are a full human being that is here and we are going to cater to your needs. So I feel like, you know, that and, you know, just making it different than, you know, what we have in this in here in Seattle was what caused the children to want to come. You know, I remember there would be kids that would miss, you know, coming and they would be mad at the fact that they missed coming to madrasa, right? They would say, this is what happened. And, you know, I didn't want it to happen, but this is what happened. You know, now we stopped it in September. And I know that, you know, there are, you know, a lot of parents that, you know, were not happy with the stopping, but life changed and, you know, it moved on. But alhamdulillah, that was a... That was the plan on how to make it, you know, fun for the kids at the same time, you know, not compromising on what they're learning.
Is it, I don't know, just from observing the environment, are a lot of these duksis closing? Well, what is going on in terms of the access to madrasas in this environment? I know in certain places like maybe Minnesota or other parts of Texas, over here in Seattle, I don't see the plethora. Maybe it's more like a private type of tutors coming. Yeah. What is that, do you think?
So I think, one, we don't have as many Muslims as we, you know, we do in Minnesota. Mm-hmm. So the madrasas are different. Here, they're more based on individuals. And what I mean by that is that you have parents that are dedicated to one ma'alim, mm-hmm. right? One teacher. So they would always take their kids there. And the ma'alim has no desire to change the way that he's teaching, because what he's doing, it's working and it's going. Why change it? Mm. You know, to him, why change it if it's not broken?
Exactly.
But when we look at it, you know, not being in that place, we're like, this is not working out, because the kids that finish the Quran here, they turn out to be the worst type of kids. Right. And this is really a sad reality that we're seeing. How many of the kids that, you know, finished the Quran, even when I was in high school, the kids that finished the Quran, where are they today? Mm. You know, what are they doing? And their parents are really confused. We took them to madrasa. They went and they, you know, finished the Quran. Why are they like this? You know, so they here, it's more of, I'm going to go to madrasa because I know this teacher. I know that he's someone that finished the Quran, and I can take my kids and he's going to make them finish the Quran. So that's the type of madrasas we have. I don't think we have any, you know, large madrasas that are working as they should. Mm. But we have madrasas that are, you know, fulfilling the basic need of teaching them the Quran. Mm. So I think that's what we are. But again, this is, you know, we don't have that many many programs because we don't have, you know, that many Muslims here.
Exactly.
Yeah. So gotcha. I feel like that's why it's not out there like in other places.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
You know, subhanAllah, with you gaining knowledge and going out and learning about Islam more, I want to ask you this, right? Because to be able to connect with your faith is to know your faith. What is this teaching? Who's the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Who's Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala? And I think your madrasa, which the program that you started, you taught the kids the why. I talk to a lot of people and it's like they don't, at 20, at 30, some people don't even know the why. Yeah. I know some elders that they don't know why they follow what they follow. And it's almost like they boiled it down to, oh, this is just what my forefathers or whatever did. So I want to ask you, like, how do you go about being able to connect with your faith through knowledge, right?
So, you know, just with anything in life, if you don't know, you cannot, you know, claim to be like, to be something. For example, I'm Oromo, right? If I don't know what that means, if I tell you that I'm Oromo and you ask me, what is that? And I can't tell you, you're not going to believe me. You're going to say, this is not what you are. Because I don't even know what that is. Same if you told me you're Somali and I asked you, what is that? And you had no clue what it was. But all you know is that my parents told me that I'm Somali. What does that mean? You don't know anything about it, so you can't say it. And it's the same for, you know, this religion of ours. We are not, you know, blind followers, right? The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he came to teach us. Right, the best way to get closer to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala and to be on the straight path. So we have to be people that are students, that are learning these things. And if you have no knowledge of why you pray salah, forget the why, or even how to pray salah, how to make wudu, how to, you know, what are you saying when you say bismillah, when you're eating and when you're drinking? But your parents told you, you know, you should say bismillah. You should eat with your right hand. These are the things that, you know, we do before we sleep. This is what we do. If you don't know how to do those things, when you, you know, you have to look at it when you get older and someone tells you, this is not how you pray. Mm. Islam does not teach you. This is not the way that you pray. And you have been praying like this the past 40 years, the past 30, 20 years, whatever it is. And you never actually went to learn what this is, something I'm doing for the rest of my life, right? For us, Islam, it's not, you know, something that we turn on and off, right? I'm a Muslim this time and I'm not a Muslim these times. It's something that we have to stick to from the time that we're born until we pass away. So how important is it for us to learn why we're doing these things and how we should do it? How should we pray? What do I say? What does it mean when I say Allahu Akbar? Or is it just something that, you know, I just say for, you know, 17 times, more than 17 times a day, and I just continue to, you know, live like this without knowing, you know, Islam. So the moment that, you know, you learn even these basic things, one is going to, you know, inspire you to want to learn more, because Islam, it's, you know, the knowledge in it is very vast. But in order for you to access the vast, first you have to, you know, go inside, you know, take a dip in, look at it. If you don't look at it, you're not going to be a, you know, a person that can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How are you going to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you don't even know who Allah is? How are you going to worship the, you know, follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam if you don't know who he is? How can you do the, you know, those things? And it is through knowledge that you get to know Allah and you get to know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and you get to know your religion. So this is, you know, knowledge, and this is how it's going to help you connect to your deen and it become a part of your life that you understand, right? Look at, you know, the things that you like or the things that, you know, people like. The things that they like are the things that they know the most about.
Wow.
You know, like if I, perfect example, let's say we're talking about sports and we talk about basketball. If you were to ask me who's my favorite player, my favorite team, what can I say that I'm a fan or that I watch basketball if I don't know none of the names of the players, none of the team names, you know, how well they're doing and all of this, but I just tell you, yeah, I'm a big basketball fan. You won't believe me. But if you ask me what's my favorite player and I tell you, and I can actually debate with you on, you know, the things that he's able to do, the stats that he has, right? We know all of these things about these things that we are passionate about. So Islam has to become like that, right? I have to know who are these people that I'm talking about? What is this religion that I'm talking about? Right? I'm worshiping, I'm praying, you know, reading Fatiha 17 times a day. If I just pray the, you know, the normal prayers, the 5 daily prayers, what does that mean? You know, what am I? This is something I'm doing more than anything else. And I don't know anything about it, you know? So this is, if you learn, you know, this is how it's going to, it'll be easier for you to understand, you know, why are you doing these things? And why is it such a big part of your life? You know, that's what I feel like.
SubhanAllah, I feel like you just expand on the fact that that's the foundation.
Yeah.
Now, you just mentioned earlier, like a lot of, there are Muslims here. There might not be like a lot, like in different states, right? So if we're saying that knowledge, right? As far as the access to knowledge, is it the fact that these people who are saying, okay, this is the case, I need to learn more about my faith. Do they need to hop on a plane and go to a Muslim country and find somewhere that they can have access? Is it that they stay and use the resources they have? How does someone go about the proper steps of solidifying the foundation, the most basic foundation of their knowledge to, inshallah, strengthen their spirituality?
You know, this is something that I've been trying to answer, you know, myself for a long time. You know, providing access to knowledge to people that, you know, so there are two different types of people when it comes to knowledge. There is someone that wants to learn the basics. Right. He wants to know who Allah is, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how to pray, how to give zakah, how to fast, how to perform hajj, the basic things. Right. This person, knowledge should be made available for him here. And this is the majority of the people. Then there's the minority that not only want to learn the basics, but they want to go further than that, right, and become students of knowledge. And then later on down the road, become scholars. For those, right, the beginning of it should be where we're at. Alhamdulillah, we have, you know, a lot of people that are able to teach and you know, beneficial knowledge that can teach in a way that, you know, we would understand. But the main thing that's missing from there is the language, right? The English language. When I first started learning, it was here in the States, here in Seattle, but I went to a masjid that everything was taught in Oromo. And alhamdulillah, you know, for that, because now I feel comfortable that I learned my deen and I learned my language at the same time.
Did you already have like an understanding of the language before?
I had a basic understanding, like very basic.
Really?
Yeah. But then going to these classes, you know, 3 times a week, eventually it expanded from there to where I understand everything they say. And then what happened was, because I was one of the youngest people there, and it would be majority, you know, elders that are just coming and sitting there, it got to the point where whenever I didn't understand something in Oromo, they would make sure that before they moved on, they explained it to me, right? And this is the same if you go to, you know, the Somali masjids or the Ethiopian masjids, the Desi masjids that we have, is that they have programs, they have classes on the basics of stuff, but unfortunately it's done in, you know, their language.
That language,
it's
yeah.
not done in, you know, our language that we're speaking. It's not done in English. And so that's, you know, if someone wants to be serious about learning their, you know, thing, they are different. I don't think we have different I don't think we have programs here in Seattle that can, you know, offer those knowledge. But alhamdulillah, we have YouTube, right? And there are many different, and this is, I don't want to say YouTube and then have everybody going and just, you know, looking up random pages, and then, you know, because this, it's a double-edged sword.
Yeah.
All right. The internet is, it can destroy you and you can benefit from it at the same time. So there are some, you know, resources that you can access online that you can learn from.
Gotcha.
Right.
But are you saying some of these resources are like not reliable?
Oh, for sure.
Gotcha.
Like the internet, it expanded our access to information. Not just good information, but every type of information, right? It's a place where you can find everything on the internet. Right. And this is like, you have to be aware that, you know, there are people and there are some things, some information on social media and on the internet that can really not only destroy your life, but destroy the lives of the people around you.
Wow.
Right. And this is, you know, you like this, there's really, this is the, you know, Shaitan's playfield. But if you are someone that is, that is capable of finding, you know, access to the truth, you can find it on the internet. But again, there's dangerous waters.
Yeah.
You know, it's just like stepping into a pool thinking that, you know, it's just 3 feet, but in reality it's 12 feet. Right. So you have to be, before you dive in, you have to be equipped, you know, ready to be and prepared for it. That's why one of the things that, you know, I'm working on now, before Ramadan, I started an institute, a Nawi Institute. I wanted to just give people the basic understandings of Islam. You just want to learn the basics. And there's a group of brothers that, alhamdulillah, have been attending the courses. We have a course on Tuesdays and Thursdays, four of them. We have tafsir.
Did you guys already begin this or?
Yeah, we started this.
Oh, mashallah.
And then, so it's divided into like two different parts. There's one where, one route where it's a class of for information, where you're learning things like in one class we're doing tafsir. So in tafsir we started in Ramadan from Juz Amma. We started from Fatiha in the last 10 surahs, and then now we're going upwards from the last 10 surahs to finish Juz Amma. So that is just a class for you to come and listen, and, you know, if you want to take notes and stuff. And majority of the time is just me talking.
And right? Where are you guys doing this?
We do it on Zoom.
Oh, okay.
So we do this on Zoom. So this is on Tuesdays. And then later that night, Tuesday night, there's a class with a group of brothers that we're doing Usul al-Thalatha, the three fundamental foundations. And this is a more, it's a different class than, you know, just me talking. It's a class where I'm trying to teach these brothers the basics of their religion. And this happens twice a week, so Tuesdays and Thursdays. I think, alhamdulillah, we get, you know, a good number of brothers that are, you know, tuning in, are progressing through it. And I think we're a little bit halfway through the book. So we should finish soon, and then we'll start a new book.
Mashallah.
So I've been working on it, but just like, you know, you're not aware of it, I try to make it very small just to see if this is going to work.
Gotcha.
Right? Instead of, you know, blasting it on social media and inviting everybody to it, I decided to just keep it, you know, something small. Brothers that I know are going to come to it. And alhamdulillah, for the most part, they're doing a wonderful job showing up to it. They're, you know, ready to read. They're ready to answer questions.
Gotcha.
So that's going on, right? So these are the two different routes that, you know, I'm trying to figure out. Is it just, you know, providing access to information? And the one that is just, you know, access to information, this really helps, you know, the elder community. They just want to come and listen and get the benefits and hear things here and there. So the tafsir and the hadith class that I have for them, this is what it, you know, it fits them. And then there's a class for, you know, our younger brothers that are, you know, around our age that really want to learn Islam, that don't have that foundation. So we start out by, you know, laying the foundations down for them. And then after that, if, you know, the way that I'm thinking about it is going from that to eventually expanding it to where it's more open to the public. Yeah. And then people can come and say, you know, offer different courses and say, these are the things that we want to learn. We want to follow this path. So I'm working on that right now. So inshallah, it should be ready in sometime soon.
Inshallah. So I want to ask you, like, as far as you yourself personally, as you gain knowledge, how do you feel like your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changed as you gain more knowledge in the seerah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or learning about hadith and learning more about the tafsir of the Quran? How do you think that's changed you in terms of spirituality?
Subhanallah. You know, I used to always love reading the Quran, right, from a young age. There was a little girl that used to come to our house a lot. I would say 2-3 times after school, she would come to our house. And then she's maybe 13, 14 now. And her mother came to our house recently, and we're talking about, you know, the way, like, which way I've gone, right? This path that I'm on. So the mother tells me a story. She said, you know, the first time I seen your lecture on Facebook, I was listening to it, and then my daughter came and she was listening to it. And then she asked her, you know, she said, look what, you know, what Fuad became, look what he's doing. And then she responded, of course I knew this is what he was going to do. Every time I used to go to their house, he's always reading the Quran. Right. So this is how it, you know, how much I used to read the Quran. But now when I read the Quran, I don't read as much as I used to, you know, that time it used, like, I think majority of the time I would be reading the Quran. Right. But now the way that, like, I understand what I'm reading and what I'm saying, you know, when I read Fatiha, when I'm reading Surah Al-Baqarah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these are his words and he's speaking to us, knowing what they mean, knowing why, you know, this is here, knowing when it came there. It's a whole different feeling, right? Like, you know, the more you know about a person, the more you're going to love that person, right? This is, you know, if I spend more time with you, the things I learn about you, the love that we have for one another is going to grow. And with Islam and with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's the same. The more that, you know, you learn about Islam and you learn about the Quran and the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, when to really, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam really struggled for us to have access to this deen. The amount of just looking at, you know, the big things that happened, he had to leave his homeland, a place that he spent 53 years in order for Islam to spread and to eventually reach us. So to see these sacrifices that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made, and not only the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the companions, the sacrifices they made, the battles that they had to fight against their own fathers, their brothers, their siblings, in order for Islam to prevail. You look at these type of sacrifices and knowing the things that they did, the appreciation that you have for one, Allah blessing you to be a Muslim, and then also having knowledge of what it means to be a Muslim. Of course, you know, the more knowledge a person has, the closer they are to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? So this is like knowledge. This is what it's going to do. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, he said, أَمَا إِنِّي أَعْلَمُكُمْ بِاللَّهِ وَأَخْشَاكُمْ لِلَّهِ. From amongst all of you, I am the one that knows about Allah the most. And because of that knowledge that he has about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's the one that fears him the most, right? So this is how we have to go. The more a person increases in knowledge, the closer he gets to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this, of course, has to be done with, you know, the intentions that this knowledge is being sought for the sake of Allah. Mm-hmm. If the knowledge is being sought for the sake of Allah, then it's not going to get him closer.
What are some of those other reasons that some people would take?
So there's fame, money, so people can say, you know, this person is a learned person. These are usually the things that you know, people will study knowledge for. And this is very dangerous, right? Because you're dedicating your life to something that's going to lead you to the fire, right? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, the first three that are going to be burnt by the fire, the first three that are going to be dragged and thrown into the fire, one is going to be someone that is not, that, you know, spent their life seeking knowledge. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask him, you know, why did you seek knowledge? And he says, so that I can, you know, serve your deen. I can teach the people. And then Allah will tell him, you have lied. You sought knowledge so that people can say, look at how knowledgeable this person is. And then, you know, drag him to the fire. So this is, if you seek it for any other reason except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's only one, you know, place to go to. And that's the fire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us.
Allahumma amin.
So this is how, you know, the things that, you know, generally people would seek knowledge for. Mm. And if someone is sincere, it begins in the beginning, even though there might be times where, you know, intentions, they're always changing, right? You are always going to have your up and downs, but you want to make sure the beginning and the end of it are you doing this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And in between that, you are going to have battles.
You have to check yourself.
Yeah, always. You know, intentions always changes. You know, even in salah, it can change, you know, 100 times. Why am I standing here and praying? Is it so that Allah can see me and I'm, you know, doing this for the sake of Allah? Or is it so that the people can see me praying? Right? So it's always, you know, something that's constantly changing. And you have to always battle it, make sure that you're doing this for the right things. Mm. Because at the end of the day, this knowledge that you're seeking or any action that you're doing, you're not doing it for the dunya. Mm. You know, you're doing it for the reward that is going to come in the hereafter.
MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. Mm. I want to ask you this, Sheikh. I feel like you being an imam and serving the needs of the community, I'm sure you've seen a lot of things, right?
Yeah.
What is a common struggle, right, that you see that you say, this is something that's going on, this needs to be addressed, that you want to maybe raise awareness to on this podcast?
Man, this is actually very simple.
Wow, really?
Yeah, because so I'm going to talk about the issues that I see amongst, you know, people our age.
Gotcha.
It is their belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And their understanding of Islam. This is really the biggest issue that we're seeing. The reason why the youth are not inside of the masjid. You know, some people think, you know, the masjid is not a place that is welcoming to them. It's not a place where activities are made for them. But in reality, the reason why they're not going to the house of Allah is because, one, either they don't know enough about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is, you know, the best scenario. Although in the worst case, they don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is really the struggle that we're seeing. And our parents and, you know, our leaders are not realizing that this is what America does. Mm. America is going to make you lose your religion. You are not going to keep it the way that, you know, it came. They even have a word for it, you know, assimilation. Mm. It is where you come here with your cultures, 3 generations later, all of it is going to be consumed. Wow. And you are going to become an American. Right? And there's nothing wrong with, you know, this is, at the end of the day, Allah put us here for a reason. And this is, alhamdulillah, this is a great country to be in.
Mm. We don't comfortable.
We don't fear for our safety.
That's true.
Right? We don't fear, you know, we don't hear our bombs meal. Just dropping on us. How many of, you know, our people struggle for food? You know, how many of them struggle to send their kids to school? So the opportunities are here. Mm. But the ways to take advantage of those opportunities, that's where it's lacking. So I see that, you know, we don't have a... The biggest problem, we're not teaching our youth about Islam. And we think that, you know, the madrasas that they go to is enough. And we forget that, you know, our parents, when they were in their countries, even if they did not go to madrasa, let's say they didn't go to madrasa, there would be people that would pray 5 times a day because the adhan is going off and you are going to the masjid. You see, you know, Islam around you. Here, they don't see Islam around them. And we think that they're going to be okay here. So we need to find a way to bring Islam and make it a part of our lives. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's, you know, one of the issues I see that, you know, we're really struggling with. Gotcha. We have to figure out something.
SubhanAllah. Yeah. I think it's like it's a community type of struggle. We all have to get behind this type of movement. And for a closing, right? Mm. I want to ask you, what type of advice, because we do have a lot of youth that's tuning into this. What advice do you specifically want to be delivered to the youth?
Learn. Mm. Learn your knowledge, learn Islam. And I'm not talking about, you know, learning to become a scholar. Don't learn it to become an imam or none of those. That's not what I'm talking about. Learn the basics of why you are doing the things you're doing. Why are you praying? And if you're not praying, why are you not praying? Mm. But what made you decide that I don't want to pray anymore? Learn, you know, why you wear the hijab. Learn why, you know, your parents are so, you know, very adamant about you reading the Quran. Why do you have to do these things? So then, you know, the advice that I want to give to, you know, the brothers and sisters that are listening, wallahi, it's very important that you know the basics of your deen. Know how to make wudu. You know, and people think that this is, you know, how is he sitting here and saying that I don't know how to make wudu? When you look at reality, You know, I've done many places I went to. I would tell the people, let's go make wudu together. Wallahi, even the grandparents, some of them don't know how to make wudu. How many of our parents, and this is something that, you know, someone asked me to teach one day, how to make ghusl, right? How to wash themselves when they finish their menstrual period, or when they've had, you know, sexual relations, how do they make, or they've had wet dreams, and how do they make ghusl? Majority of the mothers there, they didn't know how to make ghusl. And this was like, to me, this is not someone that's young. This is someone that has children that should have been taught these things, mm-hmm. right? They have children that are at that point where they need to know how to make ghusl. So these basic things, they are things that we have to learn so that we can say, okay, alhamdulillah, at least I know the basics of my deen. I know why I pray. I know who I pray to. I know the reasons why I'm doing all of these things. So inshallah, brothers and sisters, learn those things. Mm. Make sure that, you know, you are someone that when Allah, you know, you're asked in the grave, who is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? You know it's Muhammad. What is your deen? You know it's Islam. Who is Allah? You know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. So this is my final advice, inshallah.
Inshallah. Thank you so much for that advice. SubhanAllah. I feel like I benefited first of all. And I think those listening, inshallah, will benefit. Allah accepts it. Ameen, Allahumma ameen. To those listening, if you feel like this was beneficial, inshallah, go ahead and tune in to Sheikh Fuad's Instagram. You want to shout it out?
Oh, no, you know, I'm off of social media.
Are you serious?
Yeah, so I rarely go on there. Gotcha. But I'm thinking now that, you know, it's time to make a comeback.
Inshallah.
Probably I'll send it to you. You could put inshallah. It in the, you know, definitely, in the thing to look.
I'll put it on the screen, inshallah.
Yeah, inshallah.
But go ahead and subscribe and share it to a friend or some family members, inshallah. I feel like this would benefit them. And thank you guys. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.